So I'm talking about this work called Monument, and then in brackets Brick. It's a remake of an old work, one of the first works of art I ever made in 1988, when I was still a student at art school. And the brick was much smaller then, and it was made with a Xerox. But except for that, it's exactly the same object. And I decided to bring it back as a monument. I made it already 5 years ago. And I decided to exhibit it on this exhibition because I think the context of African art and the context of the African art gallery makes sense. So, as a student, I was taught by a lot of my professors had studied at St. Martin's School in London. So when I was at art school in Johannesburg in the 1980s, during the height of apartheid, many of my professors, especially in the sculpture department, had studied in London at St. Martin's in St. Martin's School of Art, and had been taught by Anthony Caro. And one of the lessons that we were taught at art school was that Anthony Caro had been assistant to Henry Moore, and his great legacy had been to take the sculpture and take it off the sculpture base and put it directly on the floor. And it was purely about its formal elements. It was about the line, the color, the texture, and the interaction of planes and lines and materials. And I thought as a student during the time of apartheid that what I wanted to do was take that one step further. And the idea was to keep the object on the floor, but then to put a line around it on the floor directly. So then the object becomes the scene of a crime. The idea being if somebody died, you'd put the silhouette of the body around the dead body. So like this, the object is on the floor, you have the tape around it, and it becomes a crime. Now, in order to look at this work, something interesting happens. You have a text on the side that is actually scanned from the newspaper, and you have to, in order to read it, you have to go down on your knee. You have to normally go down on one knee and get close to the object to read it. And when you're doing that, you change the way that you read art normally because your body is changing position, and you're actually paying homage. It's almost like a form of prayer to the object. Now, the object itself is a red clay brick. A red clay brick because we are made out of red clay, according to the Bible. But the red clay brick, for me, stands for Carl André. In the history of art, it's the legacy and the language of minimalism. It's Carl André's brick. Except Carl André's brick here becomes this crime on the floor. And we can read a lot of things. All of a sudden, Carl André's aesthetic becomes an ethical question, becomes a political question. It becomes a political question that you can read through the entire history of apartheid in the object. So the article was scanned directly from the newspaper. The article doesn't even have the name of a writer. It's just written at the bottom, SAPA, S-A-P-A, South African Press Association. The story was so common and so banal and so quotidian that it didn't even need an author. It was happening every single day. The story tells you, it starts with big letters, Mabatu. Now immediately, you would know, further on in the first sentence, it tells you as well, but you would know that Mabatu is the capital of Maputo-Tswana. During the apartheid times, the South African government created the Bantustans, which were the homelands where they would, black people would have to register, depending on the language they spoke, in one of these Bantustans. If you spoke Zulu, you'd have to go to Zululand. If you spoke Tswana, you'd have to go to Maputo-Tswana. You'd have to register, and then you would receive a dompas, which is essentially like a passport, and then you'd have to get permission to travel to work. So it's a form of controlling the movements of people, where they could live, where they couldn't live. So the story tells you a family from one of these Bantustans. It says, a family of six suffocated at Takaneng in Maputo-Tswana at the weekend. So a family of six, it's already telling you it's bigger than a nuclear family. It's already telling you it's a fairly large family. And they're living in a homeland. Police said a mother and her five children. Now, a mother and her five children, where's the father, where's the man? Well, the man is obviously in a gold mine somewhere in Johannesburg, and he's obviously being displaced. So you're talking about the breakdown of the family by the apartheid system, where the men had to work and the women were left behind to take care of the family as best they could. The story continues, she used a hot brick to warm her bed and it caused their bedding to smolder and give off smoke. Now, you know the fact that she is using a brick to warm her bed says she doesn't have electricity. It's telling you that she's uneducated. It's telling you that she's cold, so she doesn't have proper ventilation, she doesn't have proper heating, and she's living there with her five children. Now, it says, police spokesman, Colonel Dave George, now he has a name, so therefore you know he's white. The family doesn't have a name, so therefore you know that they're black.
I'm ready.
So the article tells you, it says, a family of six suffocated in Takaneni in Maputo-Tswana at the weekend. So you know it's a family of six, which means it's bigger than a nuclear family. It's a fairly substantial sized family by any standards. Police said a mother and her five children. So where is the father? Where is the man? A mother and her five children. So that's a fairly large number of children for one woman to be taken care of alone. The man is obviously in Johannesburg in a gold mine working, or somewhere in a factory. So you see, the family has been broken. The system of the Bantustan was to send the men into the gold mines and leave the woman behind to take care of the children, breaking up families, breaking up community life, breaking up the sense of family. She used a hot brick to warm their bed, and it caused the bedding to smolder and give off smoke. So she's using a hot brick, which means that she's cold, so it means she doesn't have proper heating in the house. She heats the brick up inside a fire, which tells you she doesn't have electricity. And she's putting a brick in a fire in order to warm her bed, which tells you she's probably uneducated. And it speaks about their bed, which means they're all sleeping in one bed. It's not a mother and five children in six beds, it's a mother and five children in one bed. So you're getting a sense of the living conditions of this family. Police spokesman, Colonel Dave George, he's a colonel, and he has a name, therefore you know he's a white policeman. The family doesn't have a name, not even mentioned anywhere, but you know immediately by reading the article that it's a black family. Said that due to proper ventilation in the room, the smoke suffocated the entire family. So, lack of proper ventilation means no windows, means it's small, and they all died. So it means that there were a family of a mother and her five children probably living in a corrugated iron shack. So in this story, you can see the entire living condition of how apartheid had destroyed family life. And the brick of Carl Andre suddenly is the brick that she doesn't have in order to build a house. And she's making these houses out of whatever makeshift materials that they can find. So I made this work in 88, the idea of taking an aesthetic and making it into a politics, taking an aesthetic and making it ethical, taking a neutral object like a brick and turning it into a weapon, turning it into the scene of a crime, transforming it into something that poses more questions than answers. So in order to look at the work of art, you need to read the work of art. In order to read the work of art, you go down on your knees to get close to the text. And in this process, you change the way you normally would read a work of art, which would be passive. Suddenly now you have to become active and change your body and say a prayer to the object, say a prayer to the red brick, say a prayer to the monument which tells the story about a family who tragically died because they didn't have a proper house and used a brick to warm their bedding, which killed a mother and her five children.